This story is called The Mitten. Christmas of my childhood takes place at my grandparents' house. The house was alive with cousins and dogs. It was a lot of action for my grandmother, so she made a few rules to help ease the chaos. My grandfather's office was off limits. We were allowed to enter for one reason. In the lower left-hand side of his roll-top desk, there were three books, and if we asked permission, we were allowed to go straight to the desk and take out a book. Now, this was forbidden territory. The desktop housed a Smith Corona typewriter and a photograph of Granddad when he was running for county treasurer. On the walls, there were documents of graduations and a picture, one that I coveted called His Station and Four Aces. It was a painting of a group of dogs of various breeds playing poker. I imagine Granddad drawing great inspiration from that art. Then I'm off to his desk drawer. The first book I pull out is called Curious George Goes to the Hospital. It was about a monkey who swallows a puzzle piece and is rushed to the emergency room. This information in that book got me through many long months of childhood visits to hospitals. Another was a little golden book called The Little Engine That Could, about a small engine that agreed to pull a train over a hill, and he kept repeating, "I think I can, I think I can," until he got to the top and then yelled, "I thought I could, I thought I could," as he raced down the other side. This book was very useful when I started dating. The third book was a Ukrainian folktale called The Mitten. It's the story of a little boy who loses his mitten, and one by one, the forest creatures come upon it, a mouse, a frog, a fox, and finally a bear, and they each crawl into the mitten for warmth, joining the others who came before. Finally, the boy returns, finds his mitten, and the animals all scatter into the forest. You know, I was always losing mittens, so I like to imagine that my lost mittens provided housing for all the animals between home and school. But the story bothered me because I couldn't see how a mitten could hold a bear or a fox, let alone a rabbit and mice. It just didn't make any sense. I mean, did Ukrainian children have really large hands? In my grandparents' living room, I faintly hear a Texaco Star Theater Christmas album playing Johnny Mathis, Nat King Cole, Patsy Cline, Doris Day. And under the tree are boxes and boxes. I know in there are Hot Wheels cars, Tonka trucks, Lincoln Lodge, Etch-a-Sketch, chemistry set, G.I. Joe's, Rock'em Sock'em robots, a Chatty Cathy doll for my sister, and, you know, something nice for my brother. You know, maybe a pair of socks. After we unwrap the presents, we wrap ourselves in coats and scarves and bundle off the church. It's full of farmers and it smells like hair tonic and tractor grease. The services are painfully long. The pastor has a habit of taking a point long past its expiration date. I mean, the worst was the Sunday he read through the entire list of begats in Genesis. And the son of Ham and Mizraim and Phut and Canaan and Cush begat Nimrod begat, oh man, on and on and on. I mean, I've been told there are actors who can read a phone book and make it interesting. Well, this pastor wasn't one of them. Luckily, every Christmas, we attended the special early service provided by the youth group. Usually, it was a rendition of Michael Row the Boat Ashore, and then the beaming youth pastor getting up to deliver the sermon. I mean, this was his one shot of the year. So he reads from his modern Bible that had translations about Jesus, like making the scene at Bethlehem, and he calls Herod the man and says he wore groovy threads. He talks about those who live by the sword, but it's pretty obvious he's really talking about Vietnam. Every once in a while, he glances over to the senior pastor, who lowers his eyebrows and shifts uncomfortably. But one year, the combination of popular disaster films like Airport and Poseidon Adventure met with the newly invented Moog synthesizer and inspired a program called Disasters of the Bible. It was clear from the outset the youth pastor had no hand in this. He sits next to the senior pastor with their heads down. Okay, the lights dim. A student reads, "In the beginning, there was paradise, but man couldn't leave well enough alone. And God did saith, don't make me come over there. But did man listen? No. Then ye shall know my wrath. A rumbling sound begins. At first, it feels like it's coming from underneath us. Farmers look around the pews. The rumbling grows. Finally, the synthesizer is used to full effect, and we are ushered through catastrophes of biblical proportions. The towering inferno of Babel. She's gonna blow! The walls of Jericho. Ruth, my hand! I can't reach Ruth, no! Moses in the land of Egypt. Pharaoh, let my people go. No, sonic walls of high-pitched locusts. No, sounds of oozing blood. Okay, you can go. Wait, I changed my mind. The wall of Red Sea. A chorus yells, no! Then chirping birds. A new day dawns. Thank you. Amen and amen. The congregation has frozen looks of terror. Blood trickles from some of their ears. The students hold hands and bow politely. The congregation applauds. Applause in church. Both the pastor and the youth pastor seem surprised and displeased by the reaction. Christmas is clearly now in the hands of the masses. Not good. One year, my parents decide to host Christmas dinner. A 1962 Volkswagen Beetle pulls up in front of our house. It's my mom's sister, and her family piles out like it's a clown car. More relatives arrive. My Aunt Floy and Aunt Charlene, they hug me, call me by my brother's name, and say how much I've grown. Uncle Don arrives, my dad's brother. He asks, "Why didn't you get a full-size tree this year?" Dad says he likes his little tree. His brother says, "There are three things in life that can never be too big, and I'm guessing one's a tree." Uncle Johnny comes in, and he goes straight to the bathroom. Whenever he comes over to our house, Johnny has to fix something. He's in the bathroom a long time, and when my dad finally opens the door, he finds Uncle Johnny and a dismantled toilet. Dad says, "Johnny, what are you doing?" Johnny informs Dad the wax ring on the toilet was going. In fact, it was about to blow. He says he'll have it fixed in a jiffy if Dad brings him his spare wax ring. Dad says, "I don't have any wax rings." So Johnny asks, "Where's the nearest hardware store?" Dad says, "They won't be open on Christmas, Johnny." But Johnny puts on his coat and he says he'll be right back, and he's gone. Now the ants are going full steam in the kitchen. One's on the gravy, one's on the potatoes. Aunt Mary says, on doctor's orders, she has to tie her husband's hands behind his back 6 times a day. And she's worried that tying up her husband 6 times a day makes her kinky. Mom says, not unless she enjoys it. And everybody laughs, except for Mary, who gets a worried look on her face. For Christmas dinner, every year at my grandmother's house, we always had country ham. Country ham is preserved with salt, sugar, and pepper. It's tightly wrapped in a cloth bag and hung in a ventilated place for months, for years. And a week before Christmas, Granddad takes it out of the rafters, cuts off the thick mold, and inside is the most delicious, salty treat, like a magic meat geode. The ham is soaked for a day or two in water to try to pull out some of the salt. Now, I'm not sure if this even makes a difference. I mean, country ham is not an acquired taste. You have to be born to it. It's like other foods from other cultures around the globe. Dishes that use various techniques for preserving food long before refrigeration, like lutefisk in Norway or sauerkraut in Germany or kimchi in Korea. They're flavors we really don't need anymore, but they remind us of how good we really have it. Flavors not for the timid. And I already know at 3 o'clock in the next morning, I'm going to wake up and rush to the kitchen for water, where I'll find all my cousins huddled around the sink and a running tap. I mean, there isn't even time for a cup. The mouth goes right under the tap. And after about a gallon of water, what feels like two strong men squeezing my kidneys slowly release, and it's back to bed. Now, somehow, this Christmas, my dad has found a country ham. Mom sets the ham down, and the whole table gasps. It feels like it's the Cratchit's house on Christmas when they see the turkey. The younger kids are asking, "What is it? What is it?" And we all say, "You're going to like it." And they do. I mean, it's genetic. All of a sudden, Johnny comes running back in with the wax ring. He says that he found a guy in the parking lot of the hardware store who was putting a subfloor in his nephew's basement. The guy happened to have a wax ring at his house, so my uncle traded him some rebar he had in the back of the truck. The wax ring is dubbed the Christmas miracle. After dinner, we all assemble in the living room. We're warmed with apple cider, and we sit in front of the Zenith color TV. We watch the Ten Commandments. Edward G. Robinson is the slave master. Yeah, Moses, where's your God now, see? I love watching Bambi with my uncles, all avid hunters. I mean, by the end of the movie, you're all shouting, "There's one in the meadow!" The aunts move into the living room, and an uncle tells about the time he got an orange during the Depression, and he tears up. There's an argument on who got the dog. I got the dog. No, that was my dog. A cousin's new baby gets passed around. I have to be so careful with this baby. And as I hold her, it's clear all of a sudden why God sent Jesus as a baby. When it came time to teaching a sinning world a lesson, what else could he send? I mean, he already tried floods and bugs and famine, other devastations. Then what does he visit upon a corrupt and careless world? A baby, fragile and helpless. Like, take care of your faith or it will die. God was so way ahead of us. It was like when my brother looks at a rock and my dad says, "Don't even think about it." How does he know? I look around the room, and in this baby, I can see my uncles, my aunts. I see the past, the future, all at once. I think of the begats, all of us, my grandparents, all of us, part of this baby. I look around the room, and I realize we all do belong. We all do fit in the mitten.